young, I described my father to my friends as the black Felix Unger. A former military man, he's meticulously neat. Or as my daughter Chloe later says about me, OCD. He has incredible self-discipline and has a great sense of style and class. My sister and I were raised well. We had everything we need and we want. Car, clothes, home. My parents work hard to support us. My father has a great job working for General Motors in Tarrytown in New York. He has other businesses too. He and my uncle have a smoke shop and a laundromat and a florist shop. My mom subs at the post office a 4-hour overnight shift. That allows her to be home with my sister and me. We're raised traditionally. My sister and I go to Catholic school and go to church every Sunday. Funny though, mommy and daddy never go with us. When we're very young, we never question that. But when I'm 10, I realize that maybe things aren't the way they should be. Oh, another night, and I'm awakened from my sleep. I hear those sounds again. Oh no, here we go again, once more. Mommy and daddy are arguing and fighting. Yep, it's physical. Sounds like mommy's getting hurt. She's yelling and screaming. I sit up in my bed. My sister's awake too. She's looking frightened, but she's not saying a word. So as the oldest of the two, I feel protective. The volume starts to increase, sounding scarier. And I know I must do what I've done before. I dial 911. My heart pounds, but somehow I'm unafraid of talking to the operator. Yet again, two policemen come to the front door. I stand in the doorway of the hallway. I see this piercing look from my father directed at me. I'm sorry, Daddy. I'm sorry. I love you. I love Mommy too, though. Why do you two put me in this situation where I have to choose which one of you to protect? I'm just a kid. Here I am thinking my father is beating my mother pretty bad. But then I see her in the living room looking like she's been fighting, but she's not defeated. She's strong and her face is firm and she looks warrior-like, like she can go another round. Just like other times, my father, being a male, is taken by the cops, I assume, to jail. Worse than hearing or seeing my parents fight is the feeling that I betrayed my father. And it's hurt him more than that pot my mother hit him on the head with. When I'm 11, my parents get divorced and my father moves away to Florida. After he leaves, there are no calls, no letters for years, 6 to be exact. My mother never mentions him, never speaks of why they split, why he went away. I think of him as dead. 6 years later, it's time for me to graduate from high school. I'm a good student, and I'm graduating with second honors. I send my father an invitation to my graduation. I want him there. I want him to see me now, to see how I've all grown up. I'm no longer a little girl. Not yet a woman, but I'm on my way. After he receives the invitation, he calls. He's coming. Uh-oh, I gotta tell my mother. She has a boyfriend, and he's definitely coming. As a matter of fact, he came to my graduation from St. John's Middle School. He's a very nice man, and they've been together for a few years now. I don't want to have to choose between my parents again. I want them both to be there. My dad arrives, I run downstairs, and I get in the car, and I'm so excited. He looks great, still slim and clean and neat and smelling good and nice car. He compliments me on my appearance. He's looking looking at me, though, almost with an apprehensive fear. Maybe it's because when he saw me last, he had a suitcase packed, and he was being escorted out of the house by two policemen. There was sadness then. But not today. Today I'm happy. Today I have my father back. And he tells me, sorry, can't attend your graduation. But I can take you there. My heart sinks. I want so much for him to see all my friends. And I want for them to see him especially. He's so handsome and so well-groomed and tall and young-looking. They would be impressed, and I would be proud. But it's not to happen. Well, arriving at the high school auditorium, I hate to get out of the car, but I say goodbye and thank you to my father. And as I reach for the handle on the car door, he gives me an envelope. Thank you, Daddy, I say. He's now in a brownstone in Harlem, and in the fall, he takes me shopping for college. For my tennis courts, he gets me a nice Wilson bag, tennis balls, and a Chris Everett racket, which I still have today. And might I add, is in excellent condition. We talk, but the conversation is strained. It's almost interview-like. Do you have a boyfriend? No, sir. Is anybody bothering you? No, sir. Well, just let me know. Just let me know. Yes, sir. For the next 2 years, my father is in my life part-time, usually Saturdays only. We get the calls for breakfast, followed by shopping. But then, his brother is murdered in Harlem in broad daylight. I hear it's due to money. My uncle has it, somebody else wants it. My father is devastated. He finds out who is responsible, plots, and he executes his own vengeance. And then he goes to jail. After that, he relocates to Florida, and I never see my father again. 9 years later, he dies of a heart attack. All these years, I realize I have some of my father in me, some of his good qualities. I don't look like him, but I have his manner. I'm a neat freak, like he was. I have many of his traditional values. I maintain a certain degree of order and discipline, like he did. And it's a good thing, because it's helped me get through a hard time. It's been a difficult 8 years. It began wanting to give my daughter, Chloe, my only child, everything my father gave me and more. In 2007, when Chloe graduates from high school, I figure out a way to finance her college along with her partial scholarship. I quit the job I had for 9 years at a PR firm so I can get my pension money. After that, I figured I can just get another job. I've always been able to find work. What I didn't know is that the next year, the economy would tank, and jobs that use the skills that I developed as a journalism major will be harder than ever to come by. I get short-lived jobs, first as a marketing coordinator in an H&R Block for a season, then as a gym manager at the Wall Street location of Lucille Roberts, but it's difficult finding something with a growth or a future to it. How am I going to afford to live? How am I going to afford to continue to pay for Chloe's college? In 2009, I'm introduced to Bottomless Closet. I'm interviewed, then selected from a vast number of women enrolled in a customer service program sponsored by HSBC. And the MELC program. I've never heard of the organization, but my life is so full of uncertainties at that time, so I figured, why not check it out? I mean, I'm told I'll receive a 5-day work week wardrobe, and what woman would say no to that? So I go, and lo and behold, there are lots of women, all in the same situation as I. Unemployed, experienced, skilled, wanting and needing to work. And there It's like you died and woke up in Bloomingdale heaven. And we eat the best food and plenty of it. Oh, by the way, bottomless closet, thank you for the extra calories. Doesn't matter though, I still modeled in 3 of their fashion shows. And they have workshops. I had a productive schedule of workshops weekly. Those nights, I highly anticipate. The workshops give me focus and resources I need. They give me motivation, direction, and confidence. I find the faith and courage to achieve and redirect myself and my career. I get a job at NBC on my own, worked there nearly 3 years for The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon and Nightly News, before landing an internship this past fall semester at MSNBC and going back to Baruch for my journalism degree. I just have 4 classes away from my BA. In the meantime, I have a job at a luxury hotel working in hospitality. And here's the icing on the cake. I've never won a raffle or a drawing or anything in my life. But in October 2014, I got an email from the Bottomless Closet about a contest for a living room makeup. Father God, you have entered my prayer. This is mine, I know. I got this. For the first time ever, I'm going to win a contest. I can feel it. So I answer this long questionnaire with my best penmanship. I've had the same furniture for 10 years, and I need a change. First, I find out I'm 1 of 3 finalists. Sean Perry and his associates, they come to my house. They love the space and the light. 2 or 3 days later, I find out I've won.
Yes.
And in just 2 weekends, they transform my living room, perfectly capturing my style. Thanks to Bottomless Closet, not only do I have more skills and confidence, I've got a shiny new living room. My future looks bright too, as I walk it all paved with stars.